It's a real pleasure to be here. I've been to Israel before, but I've never made it this far north. So, and I heard so many wonderful things about the Technion. In fact, the New York Times regularly runs articles about how innovative a place this is. So since I care about innovation, it's great to be here. Following up on Dan's words here, you don't need to look at YouTube. I am here. So I'm going to actually tell you in person some of the things you can see on YouTube. So I started teaching at Harvard in 1984. Boy, that's over 30 years ago. Time flies. And as I started teaching, as an assistant professor, I should first of all tell you, I was asked to teach the course that none of my colleagues wanted to teach, physics for pre-medical students. These were not students who wanted to learn physics. No, they already hated physics before coming to my classroom. And most of my colleagues didn't want to teach that course because at the end of the semester, when they would see their teaching evaluations, they would come close to committing suicide because those pre-meds were not very kind to my colleagues. I didn't know any of that. Besides, I had no choice. But anyway, when I started teaching, I never asked myself the question, how am I going to teach? Which is kind of strange, right? Because the first thing you should do is ask yourself, when you do something new in your life, is ask yourself, how am I going to do it? It was perfectly clear in my mind what I was going to do. I was going to do to my students what my professors had done to me. I think we all tend to do that, right? We tend to project our own experiences onto the world around us. And I naively believed that I had learned physics by sitting in a room not very different from this one, listening to my professors teach, who in turn had probably made the same assumption all the way back to, you know, Bologna 1,000 years ago. And what happened was that very quickly I received signs that I was doing the right thing. What are the ways by which we evaluate teaching? I can think of two of them. One is the end of semester evaluation. And I already told you most of my colleagues would get very poor evaluations for this course, but I got very high evaluations, 4.5, 4.8 on a 5-point scale. So clearly the students liked me. And I could also look at their exam performance. And typically when physics is taught to pre-meds, I don't know how it is here in Israel, but in the US, it's an algebra-based course rather than a calculus-based course. Not so in my class. I gave them a full-blown calculus-based course. And I could give these students on the final exam some questions I wasn't quite sure I would do well on under the pressure of an exam. But they did well. So they liked me as an instructor. They did well on what I considered complicated exams. Obviously, I was doing the right thing. In fact, very quickly, I started to believe that I was the world's best physics teacher. And that illusion, because it turned out to be a complete illusion, went on for many, many, many years. Even though, you know, in retrospect, there was always some negative signs. You know, there would be students who would give me high ratings on their evaluation questionnaire, but at the bottom they would write, physics is boring, or physics sucks. I could never make any sense of it. So I tend to be a positive thinker. So if I get positive signs and negative signs, I ignore the negative ones and I focus on the positive ones. Anyway, you all have one of these clickers around your neck. If you don't have one, we still have plenty here in the front, so just raise your hand and we'll get you one. I have to start with a caveat. I love technology, but I think that technology has done very little in education. Mostly because it's old wine into new bottles, right? I mean, why would using the computer to do a presentation be any better than just speaking or writing on the board? And if you actually evaluate most uses of technology in education, you find that it does not really do something new. It's just a new way of doing an old thing. I think the only real permissible or justifiable way of using technology education is when you enable something that was not possible before. So I want to emphasize that this talk is not about technology. Even though I love technology, I am not a big fan in general of technology in education. This talk is about pedagogy, and I will reemphasize that at the end. So there's always that danger in starting a talk with technology. Let me briefly explain to you how the technology works. So you all have one of these clickers. I'm going to ask you, and in the beginning I'm just going to use it as a polling tool, not as an engagement tool. Later we'll use it. I'll try to show you how you can basically use it to reawaken this innate curiosity of the human mind towards the end of my talk. So I'll ask you questions, multiple choice questions. You press a button at the end. If you think, oh, I pressed the wrong button, I pressed 2, I should have pressed 3, no worries, just press 3. This doesn't mean you get to vote twice. The 3 will override the 2. Also, once you press on a button, you'll see in the little window that number echoed. So if you press 5, you'll see a 5. That means that my computer has recorded your 5. So you have a confirmation that you've been heard. Let me show you what I see as the instructor. I have that tiny little window that floats in front of my presentation software. And notice that there's a number on there, 20. This means that 20 of you have been playing with your clickers. Very good. Why don't you press a button, everybody, and you'll see that the number goes up. For each person who clicks, the number goes up. Now, if you've clicked and you click again, it doesn't go up because simply it replaces the existing answer. At any point, I can expand this window a little bit, and I can click on this little window and see the current distribution. I guess many of you like button number 5, probably because it's in the middle. Why don't you all press number 1? Go ahead, press number 1. I love it when my audiences follow my instructions. This is great. Notice how the distribution changes right away. And before it's going to change again, I'm going to press stop here. Now, if you press on a button, you will not see the number. You'll see a circle with a line, meaning polling is closed. So that's all there is to it. And I think it's important that it's so simple. Actually, one more thing. When I hit stop here, it freezes this distribution. You can no longer change it. But it also takes a picture of what's on the screen behind. So if I review my presentation later on, I can see a picture of the screen with the data. This means I don't have to program anything, nothing. I can just use this on the fly with any type of software. This happens to be a PDF file because I use Acrobat, basically, for my presentations. So that's all there is to it. Pretty simple. Why don't you turn the clicker around for a moment and look at the back. Notice that each clicker has a barcode. It's a unique barcode. So you may think you're sitting here anonymously. No, each time you press your button, it sends a barcode, and we handed out these clickers very carefully. I'm just kidding. You are anonymous. But in a real class, we could actually track individual students. If you want it. Now, there are some faculty who actually have adopted, this is kind of interesting, this technology started after my method, peer instruction, became known. And, you know, some people thought, oh, we can make money off clickers. Now there are something like 10 companies making clickers worldwide, or in the U.S. alone, and worldwide there are many more. And something interesting happened. The clickers started to lead a separate life. People adopted clickers rather than the pedagogy. And some instructors will just lecture like did it before and simply ask a question, and then the students press a button and they get credit for that, and then they continue lecturing, which is not at all what I have in mind, as you will find out later in this course. Now, if you give students credit for clicking on a button, you can be sure that their clicker will come to class. In fact, if you look on Twitter, if you do a search clicker in class, you will see students who are attending classes with 4 clickers, their own clicker, and 3 of their classmates who are not coming to class. So by giving points, the only thing you really can be sure of is that the clicker will come to class. If you're lucky, the body will come to class too. But what you really want What you really want is the mind to come to class. And I will show you how to get your students' minds coming to class. Okay, so let's start, since this is not about technology, I already talked way too much about technology, let's start with a little exercise. I'm going to ask you two questions, and we're not going to use technology for that. I want you to write it down on a piece of paper. Basically, I want to reflect a little bit on education. What is education? And I want you to think of something you're good at, something you know you do well, something you're proud of. It could be public speaking. It could be solving partial differential equations. It could be, you know, leading archaeological digs. It could be anything, baking cakes, photography, whatever. Something you know you do really well. I want you to write that down. It's going to remain completely private. You can write down whatever you want and then hide it from other people. And the reason I'm asking you to commit yourself to it is because I'm going to ask a follow-up question that refers to the answer you write. You won't need to reveal it. Oh, and ideally, I want you to choose something that has been important in the development of your career. So unless you're a photographer, well, we have a photographer there, it's probably unlikely you choose it. You're all successful individuals, so it shouldn't take long. You know, usually when I do this in an academic environment, it only takes a few minutes before somebody raises his or her hand and says, only one thing? Yeah, pick one thing. Okay, does anybody need more time? Okay, so you can hide the answer now. You don't need to show it to anyone. I wanted you to write it down because my next question, how did you become good at whatever it is you write down, refers to it. So think about how you developed this skill or this knowledge. What did you do to become good at whatever it is that you wrote down? You know, when I asked the first question, everybody immediately started writing, and now everybody's staring. And the reason is, I think, this is a hard question, the reason is that when we're good at something, we enjoy it. We learn not because somebody tells us, learn this, it's good for you. We learn it because we want to learn it. We take ownership of the learning. So think hard and write down what you did in order to become good at whatever it is that you wrote down as answer to the first question.
More than one thing?
Incidentally, I've done this little exercise all over the world, from Patagonia in the south of Chile all the way to Colombia, Bogota, Colombia, to to Central America, to North America, Alaska. I've done it all over Europe. I've done it from South Africa to Egypt. I've done it in a number of Middle Eastern countries. I've done it all over Asia. But I've never done it in Israel. Now, the interesting thing is you get the same answers everywhere, whether you do it in Egypt or in China or in Chile or in Norway, you get the same answers to the second question. And maybe that's not so surprising, right? Because we're all human beings. Our brains are wired to learn. And, of course, the desire or the urge to learn predates any human culture. But as I said, I've never done it in Israel, so maybe you're different. We'll find out pretty soon. Does anybody need more time? Okay. If we were using a cell phone-based software, you could just type in the answer, whatever it is, but we're using clickers today, so we'll have to use a multiple choice question. Now, when I retrieve the answers to the second question, they fall into the following categories. I became good at it by trial and error, by trying it, making mistakes, and then learning from my mistakes. I became good at it by listening to lectures. Now, the word listening is not there, but it's very important. Because as the professors and the audience know, one of the best ways to learn something is to teach the course. And so, but that's not what I mean. So number two is not giving lectures. Number two is listening to lectures. I became good at it by practicing. I became good at it through, oh, pardon me. I became good at it through apprenticeship. Let me start open the voting. Hang on. I need to, there, the voting is open now. I became good at it through apprenticeship, by doing it together with somebody who's an expert, looking over his or her shoulders, and then learning from that person. And then there's other categories like friends, family, and so on. So choose the category that comes the closest to what you wrote down. And then let's see if the people of Haifa, Israel, are any different from the rest of the planet. A few more seconds. 3, 2, 1, and 0, and no. I'm happy to report that you're, or sorry, depending on your point of view, you are no different from people anywhere else in the world. Typically, I get between 50% and 70% who become good at it by practicing. Yes?
Isn't this a bit of a question of semantics? Because practicing includes trial and error.
Of course, absolutely, absolutely. So add the trial and error one to practicing, and we see that 80% learns by doing. Add apprenticeship to it, and we're at 85%, right? And who knows, maybe in E there's more. But you know, that's not why I did this little exercise. I did it because there's something else really interesting about that distribution behind me. What is it?
2% lectures.
Lectures. Only one person chose lectures. And how do we teach? This is how we teach. This is actually a picture of me teaching my pre-med course a long time ago. This picture was taken BC, before computers. See, I'm using the overhead.
Before clickers.
And before clickers too, that's right. But even before clickers. I was using an overhead projector to teach. So we see right off the bat here, there's something strange, right? You just told me that something that was important in your career, you learned not by listening to lectures, you learned it by doing. Yet our approach to teaching is one in which we basically focus on telling rather than doing. So here's what I'd like to do in this first talk. In the second talk, we'll talk about the output end, assessment. Now we talk about the input end. I'd like to talk a little bit about education. What is it exactly that happens? Or what do we mean by the word education? It's one of these words where you know what is meant, but it's really hard to articulate it. Right? If I were to ask you, write down a definition of the word education, I think it'd be tough. Many of us would be struggling. Well, we're educators. We better know. Then we'll talk about peer instruction, which Dan already mentioned, and I've mentioned a few times, which is an approach to teaching I developed after discovering that I wasn't the world's best physics teacher. In fact, I was an absolutely lousy teacher. I was fooling my students to believe that they were learning, and I was fooling myself that they were learning, whereas in reality, they weren't. And since we're in an academic environment, I thought it would be nice to end with a test. So you better pay attention because the test will come at the end. So let's start with education. What is it exactly that happens in a lecture? And ironically, I'm giving you a lecture here about not lecturing. What is it that happens? Take that picture of me standing in front of my classroom. I would like you to describe the process that's on the screen behind me using one or two words. I don't need a whole speech. One or two words. And ideally, one of those words is a verb. But there are two verbs I do not want to hear, teaching and learning. So you have to use other verbs. Go ahead, blurt it out.
Listening.
Listening, writing.
Sleeping.
Sleeping? I said, these are my students. This is my class. But you know, now that you mentioned sleeping, I can't resist a quote, which has been attributed to Albert Camus, but I think that's a wrong identification, who's once said, some people talk in their sleep. Lecturers talk while other people are sleeping. Anyway, this is my class. They're not sleeping. Look, their heads are straight, you see. Okay, sleeping, talking, writing, listening. What else?
Thinking,
hopefully.
Changing.
Processing, motivating. Now notice that all of the verbs we've heard so far refer either to them, the students, or to me, the instructor. Right? I mean, sleeping, obviously I can't be sleeping in front there because we'd have a big problem, right? Listening, well, they're listening, but I'm not listening, I'm talking. So, you know, it refers either to them or to me. Is there a way that we can encapsulate the process?
Communicating,
but to me, communication is two-way. From me to them, from them to me. That's not what is happening there. So it's not communication. Interaction will be the same thing. It's two ways. But
Downloading.
So let's call that transfer, right? Transfer of what?
Knowledge.
Let's think about that for a moment. Can you transfer knowledge? I don't think so. It would be great if you could transfer knowledge. Ideally, if you could transfer it during the sleep, would be even better, right? But I don't think that anyone can transfer knowledge to somebody who's asleep or somebody who's awake, because knowledge is something that really needs to be constructed in the brain of the learner. So what is it that I am? Information, exactly. Lectures focus on the transmission of information. And you know what? My students had actually pointed that out to me very early in my teaching career. But I had ignored it. You see, when I started teaching, I just told you that I never asked myself, how am I going to teach? What was the question you think did come up in my mind? Not what, not how, but I already said it, what? So I went to a colleague who had taught the course before, and I asked him, you know, what to teach. And he said, oh, in this course we've used a book by Halliday and Resnick. If you're a physicist or an engineer, you may know that book. It's been a classic forever. So he recommended that I would use the same book. Now, he also told me, I'd been educated in Leiden in the Netherlands, and frankly, I don't know how it is in Israel, but in Northern Europe at least, you don't buy the textbook for an introductory course. I mean, why spend the money on buying the textbook if the professor is presenting the content of the book to you? But my colleague told me, be sure that the bookstore has enough copies of the book in stock. So a month before the course started, I went to the Harvard Coop, which is our bookstore, and I said, be sure that by September 15, you have 150 copies of Halliday and Resnick in stock. And as I walked back to my office, I thought, wait a minute. If the students have the book and I have the same book, then what do I do in the classroom? So I went to my colleague, I knocked on his door, and he said, oh, don't worry, there are lots of different physics textbooks. And he showed me a shelf full of books that he had collected over his career. And I started to look, and very quickly, I found the perfect book. It was perfect for two reasons. One, it was different from Halliday and Resnick, so I was not just simply regurgitating the content of the book that they'd bought. But that was not the important reason. The important reason was the book was out of print. They couldn't get a copy of that book. So for every class, I spent 10 hours preparing lecture notes. And then in class, I would either project the notes on the overhead screen, or I would write them on the board behind me. And because my notes were different from the book, I decided to hand out photocopies of my notes to the students. So at the end of each class, as they walked out, they could pick up a copy. Now, why do you think I handed them out at the end of class? To make sure that they would listen. But isn't that already admitting that there's a problem? I mean, why force the students to get the information out of my mouth if they could have gotten the same information out of my notes? That question never came up. But you know what happened? At the end of that first year, about half a dozen students wrote in their evaluation questionnaires, Professor Mazur is lecturing straight from his lecture notes. Hello? I mean, what was I supposed to do? Develop another set of lecture notes to lecture from that was different from the lecture notes I handed out to them? These ungrateful students. But you know, the students had a point. I was lecturing from my lecture notes, and if they would have looked at the book, they would have seen that the book wasn't that different. Now, this scene that you see on the screen there is repeated all over the world. Whether you go to China, Holland, Chile, Alaska, anywhere in Africa, Australia, I forgot to mention Australia earlier. Same thing. You see lecturers stand in front of classrooms. So you could well ask yourself, is that what education is? I mean, it's not a crazy question, right? Is education just the transfer of information? I mean, if somebody from Mars were to come and study the education habits of Homo sapiens, that creature could well conclude education among the human race is transfer of information. But I want to know where you stand, not where somebody from Mars would say. I don't have a slide program, but we can just do it right here. If you think that education is simply the transfer of information, press 1. If you think education is more than just the transfer of information, press 2. So let's see where we stand on that issue. If you think education is just the transfer of information, press 1. If you think education is more than the transfer of information, press 2. Yes and no. 1 yes, 2 no. Yes, indeed, there are other options. Some people chose C and another person chose J. Well, I'm going to ignore those, but I'm happy to see that we are quite unanimous there. First, you know, the one or two individual who chose yes. I have a warning for you, especially if you're teaching. You're about to lose your job. Because let's imagine for a moment, I know we don't agree on that. We don't agree with that statement. But let's imagine that education is just a transfer of information. What would be the logical, the pragmatic thing to do? If education were just the transfer, I'm not saying it is, but if it were just a transfer of information, what would be the logical thing to do in the 21st century? Read. That's one. Well, we could have done that already since Gutenberg invented the printing press. But, you know, film the best possible professor in sociology, in engineering, in physics, and put it online. Do it in English, do it in Hebrew, do it in Spanish, do it in Chinese. Put it online. In fact, it's already happening. What would we lose by doing that? Other than our jobs, right? But in addition to our jobs, what would we lose by taking all of the classes, all of them, and putting them online?
The interaction.
But let's face it, how much interaction is there? I'm working really hard on interacting with you, and it's not simple. It's not easy. It's not easy because of the architecture of this classroom, which is modeled after what? Who designed this type of architecture, that type of architecture? The ancient Greek, I heard somebody say it. Yeah, the ancient Greek. Did they design the amphitheater as a learning space? No, it was for performance, for theater, so that everybody could see and everybody could hear. Did the Greek use the amphitheater as a learning space? No, if you look at an illustration of the school of Athens, not very far from here, you see people walk and talk and discuss and talk in pairs. Very different from that. But somewhere in the Middle Ages in Europe, we adopted the performance space as a learning space. Now remember, when you walked in here and you sat down in your seat, the mindset you bring is, I am going to listen and observe, not I'm going to interact. In a play or in a concert, it would be disruptive. if you spoke up and make noises and interrupted the performer. So you bring that same mindset to a classroom. It's very hard. You turn into a passive observer as soon as you sit down in a seat in a learning space designed like this. So I think you'd lose very little interaction. In fact, on my own campus, I make a point of observing colleagues teach. I'll go into the Science Center, this is our Science Center, and I'll watch Steven Pinker or one of the other, you know, great Harvard professors teach. And many of them give fantastic lectures, animated, exciting. And after talking for a few minutes, they stop and they say, does anybody have a question? Anybody? And the students look down, they don't want to make eye contact. And then if the instructor waits long enough, it's always the same person in the front row who asks questions. So I think there's very little interaction. So by putting it online, I don't think we'd lose very much. We'd actually gain something. Because you see, in a lecture, your mind is held captive by the lecturer. You cannot think. Well, you can think superficially, but not in any cognitive, deep, meaningful way. If you all of a sudden think, I wonder how this is, well, you start thinking, you're no longer listening. Our minds are not made to multitask. We either think or we listen. Well, if we think, we're not listening, and we know we're missing information, so we better suppress the thinking and make sure that we take the information down. In fact, I've heard somebody describe this process there, the lecture, as a method whereby the lecture notes of the instructor get transferred to the notebooks of the students without passing through the brains of either. And in a sense, that's what's happening in many lectures. Have you ever, in your classroom, had a student raise his or her hand and say, Professor, could you please be quiet for 5 minutes? I need to think. It's never happened in my class, but you have to admit, if you're really wondering about something, that needs to happen. Online, you can do that. When you read a book, you're in control. If you want to think, you stop reading, and then you read again. Online, you could watch, stop, and then think, I wonder about this, or watch again. So I think, this is my point, if education were just a transfer of information, then we're doomed. Because there are much better ways of transferring information than you know, giving a lecture, live or even online. So let me now turn to the people who said no. What is it that is missing? What more is education if it's not just the transfer of information? 93% of you said no, so what is it more than just a transfer?
Training people how to think.
Training people how to think? Practicing. You need to do something with that information. It's not enough to open your skull, put it in, close your skull, regurgitate the information. You need to do something meaningful. You need to connect that information to pre-existing information in your head. You need to develop the mental models that permit you to apply what you've learned into a new context. Something we'll talk about in the second talk, because I think that's so crucial, transfer. You know, in Northern Europe, we tend to pride ourselves in good education, but I think it's all an illusion, too. I grew up partially in France, partially in Holland. When I was in France, the emphasis was on French history. When I was in Holland, the emphasis was on Dutch history. And I remember learning at some point in high school, in 1660-something, I forgot the year, I'm sorry, the Dutch defeated the British in the River Thames, just outside London. On the exam, in what year did the Dutch defeat the British? I'm sorry, I forget. Maybe somebody can Google it for me. I don't know. I must have remembered it long enough to pass the exam. But, you know, frankly, I have no idea why the Dutch were fighting the British or how they managed to defeat them. Did remembering that date long enough to pass the exam make me a better citizen? Did it teach me something that is actually useful other than a fact? I think no. So I think what you need to do as a learner is synthesize the information, assimilate it. It's not the transfer, it's not the remembering, sorry, it's the assimilation, the accommodation, as Piaget would have called it, of this information. Well, it took a long while before I discovered the result. The result was actually frightening, and I discovered that something like after seven years of teaching, I read in a paper about a test that tests students' understanding of the concept of force. Now, in a physics course, force is discussed typically all the way in the beginning. I learned it in high school. Okay? When I went to university, we didn't even talk about forces anymore. But anyway, these students still got force, but we discussed that in week one. And most of the students at Harvard already have taken 2 years of physics in high school, so I went very fast through that. But that article claimed that in Arizona, New Mexico, California, and Colorado, thousands of students who had taken this questionnaire that has 30 questions that are purely word-based, I'll give you an example in just a second, that they did as poorly at the beginning of the course as they did at the end of the course. Let me give you one example. A heavy truck and a light car collide head-on on the highway. Bang. During the collision, the force exerted by the heavy truck on the light car is A, larger than the force of the light car on the heavy truck. The two forces are equal. Or the force of the light car on the heavy truck is larger than the other way around. Now, all students in introductory physics can recite Newton's third law. You may have heard of it. Action is reaction. Or the force of object one on object two is identical in magnitude to the force exerted by object two on object one. They recite that without any trouble. But something mysterious happens when you replace one by heavy truck and two by light car. All of a sudden, they're convinced that the heavier truck exerts a larger force on the light car than the other way around. Anyway, I read this and I thought, no way, you know, not my students, not Harvard students. But you know, I'm a scientist, so I've learned not just to make assertions. So I thought, I'm going to show that in my class at Harvard, the students do a lot better. It took only, so one day, it was already the, I couldn't do it at the beginning of my class that first year, but it was about 2 weeks before the end of the semester. I gave it to my students, and within 5 minutes, I fell out of my ivory tower. Because one student raised her hand, and she said, Professor Mazur, how should I answer these questions? According to what you taught us, or according to the way I usually think about these things? I had no idea how to answer that question.
But they're
going to
be doctors.
They're going to be doctors, yeah. Anyway, that changed my career and made it clear that there was actually no learning in my classroom. Because, you know, if you don't understand force, physics is like a scaffold, right? I mean, momentum, energy, work, it all builds on force. If you don't understand force, nothing makes sense. Nothing. You have to memorize it. And it became clear that my students were basically memorizing it. And the psychologists who've studied memory have shown, if you just memorize facts, you lose them very quickly. I'll show some data in my second talk. So it's not the transfer of information that's the matter, it's the assimilation of it. And I started to think for a while, what am I going to do? And then I realized that education is actually a two-step process, not a one-step process. The first step is the transfer of information. I mean, no transfer of information, no education. I think we all agree about that. But that's not sufficient. The learner needs to make sense of that information, build the mental models that permit the person to apply what has been learned into a new context, connect it to pre-existing information, and so on. Now, in the standard approach to teaching, all of the emphasis is on that first step. That's what happens in the classroom. And then people are sent home to make sense of the information. It worked for us. Why wouldn't it work for everybody? Well, we became professors in our disciplines. We're taking ownership of our learning. We learned not because of the way we were taught, but probably in spite of it. To expect that our students are all going to be like us is kind of a frightening prospect, because that means that the world would be very quickly covered with professors. Well, maybe we'd be a little bit better off than we're now, but still, we'd have a problem. If you ask yourself, which of those two steps is the harder one, I think we all agree it's the second one. So we should really focus on that second one. So rather than doing step one with the students, the easy one, and then leaving the hard part to them, we should give the students responsibility for the transfer of information so that we can help them in class making sense of that information. I didn't call it flipping the classroom at that time. I called it inverting the sequence. And then later somebody came up with this idea of the flipped classroom, which I think is a great term. I don't want to discuss point one. To me, that's the trivial part of education. I want to ask ourselves the following question. If you have successfully found a way to successfully transfer the information out of class, and there are many, what do you do in the classroom? And the answer to that question is really nothing new. It's teach by questioning. Who said that first? Socrates, not very far from here again. We're back to the ancient Greek. Over 2,000 years ago, said that. For me, it was sort of an accidental discovery. I'll tell you what happened. It was serendipity. My whole life has been governed by serendipity. You know, when the students saw the result of that test, that forced concept inventory, that questionnaire, not only was I shocked, they were shocked too. They couldn't understand why they'd scored so poorly. And the exam was only a few weeks later. So they went into a panic. And they asked me for a special session at night, where it goes through every single question, 30 questions, one after the other, 3 hours from 7 p.m. to 10 p.m. I remember coming to this question about the heavy truck and the light car. I thought to myself, that's simple, Newton's third law. So I turned my back to them. I drew a drawing of the truck on one side of the board, the car on the other. I drew the forces of gravity, the normal force of the road up, force of the truck on the car on the truck. And I turned around and I said, by Newton's third law, these two forces are equal to each other. What's more to explain about it, right? I could at once see from their faces that they were confused. So I asked, is there a question? They were so confused they could not articulate a question. You know how it is. So I thought, this is serious. I thought, maybe they're confused by the fact that the forces are the same, but the effects are very different. But the reason that the effects are very different is that the truck is very heavy and the car is light. So I should bring in Newton's second law, F equals ma. Anyway, in the next 8 minutes, I erased the board, I started all over again. In the next 8 minutes, I managed to produce the most brilliant explanation you could possibly imagine, okay? The whole board was covered with drawings and equations. I'd worked out the acceleration. I mean, everything. I was so proud. Of course, I'd done this all with my back to them, right? So at the end of 8 minutes, I turned around, my coat jacket covered in chalk dust. They looked even more confused. And they could still not articulate a coherent question. You know how it is, right? I mean, if you're really confused, it's hard. I didn't know what to do. Didn't know what to ask. So in a moment of despair, I don't know what got into me. I knew that half of them had given the right answer on the questionnaire. So in a moment of despair, I said, why don't you just discuss it with each other? I had 250 students in the classroom at that point. And something happened that I had never seen before. Complete chaos broke out. They all started talking. They forgot about me in front of them. I could have walked away. They would not have noticed it, okay? But what's more, in just 2 minutes, they figured it out. I thought, how can that be? I, the expert, have tried in two different ways during 10 minutes to explain it unsuccessfully, but in 2 minutes they figure it out. Let's imagine you have two students sitting next to each other, John and Mary. Mary has the right answer because she understands. John does not. On average, I won't claim this always works, but on average, Mary is more likely to convince John than the other way around because, the force of logic, so to speak. But that's not the important part. The important part is that Mary is more likely to convince John than Professor Mazur in front of the class. Why? Because she has only recently learned it. She still knows what is going on in John's head. Whereas Professor Mazur has learned it such a long time ago, to him it is so clear that he cannot even understand why somebody doesn't understand it. It's what Steven Pinker calls the curse of knowledge. Once you know something really, really well, it doesn't become easier to teach it, it becomes harder. So when I saw that, I thought, wow, I should use this in my classroom. So rather than telling, I talk a few minutes and I put a question on the screen. And then it's silent. Nobody talks. Each student has to think on his or her own about the question. Nobody to distract you. And then, basically, I polled them. Initially, we did it by simply having all the students put their hands on their chest, indicating with the fingers what choice. And I told my students, if you don't put your hand on your chest, I will ask you to stand up and tell everybody what your answer is. They quickly put their hand on it. And then I tell them, now find a neighbor who has a different answer and try to convince that neighbor that you're right and he or she is wrong. So they turn right. If the person has the same answer, they say, thank you very much. And they turn left, or you're going to have to do the same thing. And if everybody around you has the same answer, you get up and you walk around. You have to talk to somebody. I tell my students, if you just sit there without talking to anybody, I will come and talk to you, which is the last thing they want. So they quickly find another partner. Then I poll them again. And typically, if for this first poll, the correct number of answers is between about 30% and 70%, it will jump significantly in the second poll. You see, if it's lower than 30%, there are simply not enough students who know the right answer to teach others. The question was too hard. If it's more than 70%, they won't have much talking to do and they'll get off task. They'll start to talk about other things. So typically, you want to make it neither too hard nor too easy. Then either I or somebody else explains the question, and the cycle repeats until time is up. And of course, the learning takes place, the aha moments. You actually see students go, oh. You can see the aha moments in front of you in the classroom during that discussion. Let me show you a little video of how this works in practice. So, why doesn't it play? It probably doesn't play because Acrobat always asks me for permission to play the video, and I always select always, but apparently for Adobe, always means once. There we go. So we have a rectangular loop that is placed in a uniform magnetic field in the direction indicated by these arrows.
Don't worry about this question. It's not going to be on the test, okay?
What are the magnetic forces on the four different sides of this loop? So take a minute to think about this and then enter your answers.
So it's quiet. You know, I give them 2 minutes, not 10 seconds as in this video clip.
Okay, please enter your answers.
They vote.
We have a disagreement clearly here. So turn to your neighbor and see if you can convince one another of the correct choice.
Right. It goes out of the top goes in, so they cancel each other out.
See the aha moment there?
Initially we had sort of an even split, and now we have an absolutely overwhelming majority for choice number two. The bottom of this loop.
I don't show them that first distribution. I see it on my screen. They do not see it. I don't want to bias the discussion. But I do show them the second distribution. So what's going on here? One is this two-way flow of information. It's just not from me to the students. There's something coming back. If they don't understand something, I see it then and there when I can still do something about it. Secondly, it's active, not passive. It is
impossible to sleep in my classes because every few minutes your neighbor will start talking to you. The third thing is, it is an opportunity for the students to continuously try out their knowledge without penalty. It's continuous formative assessment, right? If on the second try you still have the wrong answer, one instead of two, and you see that 90% of your classmates have the right answer, there's this little red light going on. You know, I better do something about it. It's continuous feedback on the learning, which I think is so important. And lastly, it personalizes the instruction, right? Because student A can address student B's problem. Student C can address student D's problem, even though B and D have two very different problems. As instructor, I can only provide one, maybe two points of views. But I can't, you know, provide and individually help everybody. This permits it to become much more of a one-on-one individual approach. Do you want to try it? Mm-hmm. Yeah? I'd asked Abigail to hand out something on thermal expansion. Did you all read that before coming? No? I'm just kidding. But you know what that means. That means that I will need to lecture you for a few minutes because otherwise I can't ask a question. And I'm actually very happy because in my own classes I never get to lecture. And frankly, I miss lecturing, so I'm happy to have the opportunity to lecture to you. Thermal expansion. We're going to talk about hard solids like, you know, wood or steel or concrete. Hard solids like wood or steel or concrete expand when it gets hotter, and they contract again when it gets smaller. Expand when it gets hotter, contract again when it gets colder. And it's very important in engineering, and I know you're an engineering campus. For example, if you've ever been in a train at low speed, I was actually along the coastal way. We were driving back from dinner last night. We had the windows open. There was a train coming from, I guess, Tel Aviv to Haifa. I could hear it. And you heard the clickety-clack sound of the wheels as they went from one section of the rail to the other. Clickety-clack, clickety-clack. And you may wonder, why don't they put the rails together? Why do they leave this little gap that makes this annoying clickety-clack sound? Well, the reason is, if you put the rails together, it gets hotter, the rail will expand, it has nowhere to go, and bad things happen. It will buckle, right? Same thing for big steel beam buildings. You have to take into account the expansion of the steel. Next time you park your parking car in a concrete parking garage, as you walk away from your car, look down, and you'll see that every 30 meters, there's a rubber strip. There's actually a gap in the concrete that's filled with rubber so that the concrete can expand. So it occurs everywhere in engineering. Now, the reason solids expand is that they're made from atoms, and atoms get further away from each other when it gets hotter. So this is cold, and that is hot. Cold and hot. And that's all there is to it. Now, I'm not going to ask you about this, but you may wonder, why is it that they get further away from each other? The reason they get further away from each other is that atoms don't sit still. They vibrate. And the amplitude of that vibration is related to what we call temperature. So these are cold atoms, and these are hot atoms. Cold atoms and hot atoms. So they need more space when they get hotter. If you were an atom, you wouldn't just sit like this. You'd actually be shaking back and forth. As it gets hotter, you shake over a bigger room. You need more space. You push the people around you away. Cold and hot. And it's not just those nine atoms, right? In a real solid, there are millions of billions of atoms. All of them get further away from each other. Cold and hot. Questions? I knew I was a good lecturer. Thank you so much for reiterating it. Did I hear somebody say water? Water is a liquid, and we're only talking about solids. So solid water is called ice. If you take ice and you cool it down, it shrinks. And you heat it up again, it expands. Something funny happens when ice melts. As you know, ice floats, which means it's lighter than water, which means water, which is hotter than the ice, is
denser the molecules, because water is made from molecules, sit closer together. We won't talk about that. We'll talk about solids. And ice is a hard solid. It expands and contracts just like any other one. Cold and hot. You know, one thing I could do, one thing I could do is I could make this black and then ask you a question. When solids get hotter, they expand because A, the atoms get closer together, B, stay the same distance, C, further away. But that would just be me giving information to you and you giving that same information back to me. I want to see if you can take this mental picture of atoms getting further away from each other, all of them, and apply that to a new context. So you better ask me questions. Cold and hot. Cold and hot. There are no stupid questions, don't worry. Yes. Several times, yeah. So different materials are characterized by different expansion coefficient, right? So steel expands more than concrete, for example. But let's say that you take steel and you increase its temperature by 10 degrees, you'll find that the length increases, or the linear dimensions increase by a certain factor. If you then add another 10 degrees by that same factor again, and again, and again, until at some point the atoms are so far away that it melts. But we won't talk about that. Cold and hot. Any other questions?
Why do you enforce symmetry on it?
Why do I enforce symmetry on it? Just because I was lazy and I found it easy to make that drawing. Not all hard solids are crystalline like this one and will be have nicely arranged atoms. The thing that all solids have in common, though, hard solids, is that the atoms remain bonded pretty much to their nearest neighbors at all times. The atoms don't just move around like they would in a liquid. Okay, are you sure you're ready for the question? So here are the instructions. I'm going to ask you the question. You're going to think about it without talking to anyone. If I hear you talk to anyone, I'm going to come to you with this microphone. I'm going to put the microphone in your face and ask to tell, out of fairness, what you just told your neighbor to everybody. So quiet, right? Then you're going to vote. And if, you know, you can vote whenever you want because I'll open the voting. If you change your mind, it's no problem. It's only the last click that will count. Then when I tell you to talk to each other, you find a neighbor who has a different answer. So if the person to your left has the same answer, you turn to the right. If that person also has the same answer, you turn to the person behind you. You have to find somebody with a different answer. And then try to convince that person that you're right and he or she is wrong. And then I'll ask you to vote again. So here we go. Consider a rectangular metal plate with a circular hole in it. If we now uniformly heat that plate, what happens to the diameter of that hole? One, it increases. Two, there's people already voting. I'm not even finished reading the question. Two, it stays the same. Three, it decreases. I'm going to give you a minute or so to come up with an answer. And if you're among the smart 27 people who already have voted, ask yourselves, how am I going to convince somebody else that I am right and he or she is wrong? No talking yet. Shh. No talking yet. Okay, we're already at 56. Okay, so if you have not yet voted, don't worry. The answer to this question is not going to affect your salary or anything in your life, okay? There's no risk here, you know, other than maybe bruising your ego. But if you still don't know what the answer is, make it a game, okay? But do press a button. I want everybody to press a button. So consider it a game if you haven't made up your mind yet. Three more seconds. We have 66, 67. Okay, find a neighbor who has a different answer and try to convince that neighbor that you're right and he or she is wrong. Go ahead. Talk to each other. I'll finish this in about 5 minutes and we'll transition then.
And then we shall have 5 minutes.
Yeah, stretch legs. Yeah. So what do you think?
Three.
What do you think? What do you think the percentage of?
I think it's going to be very high.
Now. No. You have to try to convince.
Unfortunately, everyone.
Well, walk around. Find somebody with a different answer. Now look at this! Hello? Look at that. You all got engaged. There are still some people going. I'm sure that by now many of you have forgotten that I'm not here today to talk about thermal expansion. I'm here to talk about education. The answer to this question doesn't matter because you've already made my point here. Imagine that instead of asking you this question, I would have given the same little lecture about thermal expansion as I just gave, but instead of asking you the question, I would have said, let's now apply this to metal plates with circular holes in it. If you take one of these plates and you put it in the oven and you turn up the temperature, the plate expands and the diameter of the hole will... I'm going to keep you in suspense a little bit longer. I mean, you would have been sleeping. You would have been sleeping. I mean, what is more boring than metal plates with circular holes in it? Isn't it amazing how you can reawaken the curiosity of the human mind? I mean, take small children, 3, 4 years old. They're born curious. We're all born to learn. We're all born to want to understand the world around us. If anything, education does a really good job
turning that innate curiosity off. The good news, however, is that I've just shown to you how easy it is to turn it back on. Now, before I tell you the answer, let's analyze what happened here. I asked you a question. You thought about it. And then, after thinking about it, I had you make a commitment. You had to click 1, 2, or 3. And after making that commitment, I told you, talk to each other, and you had to externalize your answer. You said, I chose, And something interesting happened there. I could see it. Many of you were talking in Hebrew. I unfortunately don't, even though I have family in Israel, I don't speak Hebrew, so I couldn't follow it. But by just looking at your body language, it became clear. You moved away from the answer, the fact, to the reasoning. It was no longer about the answer. I think will happen because blah, 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 blah. You're trying to connect it to other things you knew. But that's not the most important point. The most important point is you became emotionally invested in the learning process. If I were to walk out now and say, oh, I have to go to Tel Aviv, I'm sorry, bye, you'd come running after me asking me what the answer is. A hole in a plate. I mean, come on. I mean, I trust me, if you can do it with a hole in the plate, there's any subject you teach that you can make as engaging as this. Anyway, before I tell you the answer, you have to vote again. Right? So vote again. Vote what you now believe to be the correct answer. 1, 2, or 3. I have some bad news for you. I thought I gave a pretty clear lecture about thermal expansion. And so did you, because, you know, I insisted on questions and I didn't get many questions. Yet only 31% of you got it right the first time. And you know, when it's 31, there's, you know, there's very, it's only one in, less than one in three, right? So most of the people will agree on some other answer. At that point, it's very hard to get an actual improvement. You should really have done your reading before coming to, I'm just kidding here. The correct answer is, look at that. Everybody's looking at, there's not one person texting or tweeting. Everybody's looking at me. The correct answer is, drum roll, number 1. And let's see where we stand here. Whoops, pardon me. Wow, look at that. Even though only 31% had it right the first time, I'm going to show you the distribution. Here's the pre-distribution. 31 went up to 46. And the predominant wrong answer, 3, went down. So even though there was only 1 in 3, those people who had the right answer effectively convinced the others. I don't want you to lie in bed tonight at 2 a.m. awake, you know. Even though I'm not here to talk about thermal expansion, let me spend another minute of my precious time explaining to you why it gets larger. Suppose you have a jar of marmalade or pickles or whatever in the refrigerator, glass jar, metal lid. And the metal lid is a ring with a plate, right? You take it out of the refrigerator, you can't open it, what do? You run the lid under hot water. The ring expands, the hole gets larger. Or a wedding ring, same thing, right? You make it hotter so that the opening gets larger. You say, you didn't ask about a ring, you asked about a plate. Okay, let's imagine we have a plate. We have no hole in the plate. We take a pen and we draw a circle. Can you imagine that? So now we have a plate with a circle. We put the plate in the oven. The plate expands. What happens to the diameter of the circle we've drawn? It gets larger. Everything gets larger. You say, that's unfair. There's no hole. If there was a hole, then the atoms would expand into the hole. Let me show you what's wrong with that argument. Imagine we all go outside in the courtyard here, and we form a big ring holding hands. Each of us is an atom at the edge of the hole. Can you imagine that? Yeah? Now let's imagine that we step in towards the center of the whole. What just happened to the distance between us? Get smaller. We get squeezed together. We can't get squeezed together because remember, we're shaking and our neighbor's shaking. Man, the only way to make the distance larger is to remove a few of us, but atoms don't disappear like that, or to make the whole larger. You won't forget this. Anyway, back to peer instruction. I wish I could show you the data, but I don't have time for this, and we urgently need a little break here. But the first year that I implemented it, I doubled the learning gain. I doubled the learning gain. And after another few years, I was able to triple it by asking better questions in class. And other people have shown that you retain the information much better, because once you understand something, it sticks. It sticks not because you memorize it, it sticks because you have the right way of thinking about it. So what happens in a lecture? In a lecture, you don't pay utmost attention. It's really hard because you have to focus on capturing the information rather than understanding the information. You also walk out of a lecture thinking you know it. You thought you knew about thermal expansion. I might well have thought that you knew it. But in reality, you had not yet been confronted with any misconception. So the reason that the lecture is so ingrained and is so hard to get out of our system is because it creates this false sense of security. The students walk out of these lectures thinking, oh, Professor Mazur gave a brilliant lecture. It was all clear. Professor Mazur thinks, I must have given a really good lecture. There were no questions. But in reality, it's just an illusion. So, in conclusion, education is not just about transferring information. It's not about getting our students to do what we do. I want my students to stand on my shoulders. I want my students to solve the problems I cannot yet solve. We want the next generation to solve the problems that this generation cannot solve. The only way to accomplish that is to actually actively engage the learners in the learning process, not just deliver information. Okay, I'll stop here. I think we'll have a few minutes break.
5 minutes.
5 minutes break. And hopefully there'll be some informal time for questions during the break and later on. Thank you very much.